Okay, so our work is also on time automata. So you defined time automata very well. So this, just let me show you. Just recall what it is. So it's just finite automata with clocks, and of course clocks. We have clock guards on the edges, and the clock resets. So this defines a very natural semantics by delay transitions, where all clocks grow by some amount, and by discrete transitions, which are instantaneous, they are taken in zero time. And such a sequence is just one behavior, one possible behavior of the system. So I will call this semantics. This is the usual natural semantics. This is the exact semantics. So time automata are, of course, abstract models. And this is why they're a bit idealistic. So for example, time automata assume that there is no minimum delay, no level bound on the delays between actions. So this means that we assume that the system is able to do two actions, one after another, with a very small delay between them. So this is, of course, not realistic in real systems. And we also assume that the clocks are perfectly continuous and they're infinitely precise. So, of course, in reality, we have digital clocks. So we can only measure time with these clock ticks. So this period could be very small, but still it's some positive period. And also we have reaction times, which means that when the system receives a signal, an interrupt, something like that, it has to spend a little bit of time treating the signal. Okay, so the program semantics was defined by DeWolf, Daniel Haskin, to take into account these aspects. So I don't want to define the program semantics, but just think of it as a very concrete semantics. So this is the real-world behavior of some digital system executing the time automaton. And yeah, we would consider, so we actually study a variant of this program semantics. Now, these imprecisions in time automata can also be modeled in a different way. So it's a time automaton with, so consider the clock constraint x is less than 2. When in the real system, you evaluate this constraint, when it evaluates to true, in reality, it only means, it can only guarantee that x is less than 2 plus some delta. Of course, because of the imprecisions. So this is an example for delta equals to 0.1. And similarly, y is greater than 2, it becomes y is greater than 2 minus delta. So we enlarge all the guards to model these imprecisions. So this is another way to model these imprecisions. And there's a relation between the two semantics. We have that for any time automaton A, all the behaviors of A are included in the program semantics. You just have to enlarge by delta. So if you enlarge all the guards by delta, like in here, then we have this inclusion. So this inclusion is actually timed simulation. So not just trace inclusion, it's timed simulation. And if you enlarge even more the guards, then the program semantics is included in the enlarged automaton. So this is based on this work and also our work. So this means that the program semantics, so the real-world behavior, could have extra behavior, additional behavior than the abstract model A. And it also means that this enlargement is an over-approximation of the program semantics. So now let me show you that, in fact, these semantics can have, in fact, extra behavior. So this is an example. This is a very simple system. You have a camera, a webcam, and an encoder. This is probably a sound card actually, but anyway. So the camera captures images, and so it captures one frame every 2 time units, and it sends it to the encoder, and the encoder has to treat these, maybe store them somewhere. And if we assume that the encoder treats each frame in 2 time units, then of course this is possible, so it's feasible. That is, we can treat as many frames as we want. So this is a very simple scheduling problem. We have a periodic task of 2 time units, and we're able to treat this, so this is schedulable. But now, suppose that you implement this system on a cheap hardware, and somehow you end up with additional unexpected delays. So instead of two time units, you have the encoding is done in 2+ delta time units. And then, of course, these deltas could accumulate over time if this repeats at every time. And at some point, you'll have you have to skip a frame in order to cope with arriving the arriving frames. So this system is, of course, a time automaton. It could be modeled as a time automaton. And the first system is this a time automaton without the delta. And it is safe in the sense that there is no frame skips. But for any delta, any positive delta, so if you model check, you'll see that you have to skip a frame eventually. So the qualitative behavior can change for any enlargement, even if the enlargement is very small. Yeah, so this was observed. So the enlarged or program semantics can add undesired behavior, different qualitative behavior. So this was observed by Puryat, first for clock drifts and then for clock imprecisions. So because of this problem, the parameterized robust model checking was studied. So in this problem, so it's just like model checking. You're given a time automaton, a property, and you want to decide satisfaction, but you want to decide if there exists a bound on the imprecisions. There's just a delta small enough so that the enlarged automaton satisfies phi. So this, yeah. So this is decidable. So this was first studied for safety properties by many people, and for linear time properties, and even for a fragment of MTL, so timed logic, timed extension of LTL. Also for time untimed language equivalence between A and A delta. So in all this previous work, the idea is to check whether this additional behavior introduced because of the imprecisions is harmless. They're harmless. So we want to check, for example, if the enlarged automaton is still safe. But in this work, we adopt a different approach. We don't want any additional behavior. We want to modify the automaton to systematically exclude any additional behavior under imprecisions, and therefore for small enough delta. So to do so, our main tool is shrinking. So we want to shrink time automata. So it's a very simple idea. So if you have this edge, this guard in your time automaton. So this is the real-world behavior, of course, because of the imprecisions. And this is why, so because of this enlargement, this is why we have this extra additional behavior. And if you don't want this to happen, a very, very simple idea is to shrink the guard, to replace this 2 by 2 minus delta, this by 1 minus delta prime, so that now this is the real-world behavior. And now if you choose these parameters correctly, of course, this will be included in the intended behavior, so it will be between 1 and 2. So idea is just to shrink more than what it will get enlarged by. And this will, of course, prevent any additional behavior. So we will consider a separate shrinking parameter for each atomic clock constraint. So this delta and delta prime can be different. And actually, we will be looking for parameters like in this form. So we'll have one rational delta and K1, K2, K3, these will be integers. So what I mean is that instead of looking for a set of rational numbers, like it here, we'll be looking for some uniform delta, so rational delta times integers. So this is, of course, equivalent. Any set of rational numbers can be written like this. There is some delta times positive integers. And yeah, so given such a vector delta, K, so this is the shrunk automaton. So this means each guard has been shrunk by the corresponding value. Okay, now here's a series of relations. So the program semantics of the shrunk automaton is included in the original automaton. So that's because the idea is that if you shrink enough, then you'll get this inclusion. But of course, so this is already a very good thing because this is the real-world behavior, and it is included in the abstract model. So if you model check A using UPAL or using the NIM algorithm, then the real-world behavior is included in your model. So if A is safe, then the system will be safe. But of course, this is not always enough because this could have no behavior, or maybe it's doing something not uninteresting. So we're interested in this semantics lightness or so we want to find these parameters delta k such that the program semantics is able to time object simulate the specification and it is non-blocking. So if you have this, if you have these conditions, then it is a very good implementation. So it contains all the intended behavior and it is non-blocking, it is safe, and so on. So just a simple observation. You also have this inclusion. So that's because, okay, so that's because here we enlarge a little bit more, so we shrunk it here. We shrink more, so that we have this inclusion. Now what we show, this is our main result, is that we show that one can decide these parameters and compute them, compute the least parameters, delta times k, for which we have, so the, A can be time object simulated by the shrunk automaton, and the shrunk automaton is non-blocking. So if you just want simulation, then this is next time. So if you have the simulation, then we, of course we have completed this circular gradient. So then the program semantics is simulation equivalent to the specification. If you just want non-blocking this, then it is in P space, and in fact NP, if the number of edges per location is bounded by a constant. So I believe this is a reasonable parameter. And if you want both, that is the same parameters delta k such that both properties hold, then it is also possible the next time. And this implies that the program semantics is non-blocking and it is simulation equivalent. So this is not obvious actually, but this is not for today. Okay, so now just to show you how a shrunk automaton looks like. So if you take this automaton, if you apply your algorithm, it will tell you that it's a shrinkable and it will give you these red shrinking parameters. So you see that, so one becomes one minus delta here, and we have two delta, three delta, four delta. So we really need to consider different parameters for each atomic clock constraint. And we have this both properties, non-blocking is a simulation equivalence for, actually for all delta between 0 and 1/4. So in general, all our results will hold for all small enough delta. Okay, also, you may wonder how to interpret these shrinking parameters. So what to do with these shrinking parameters once you apply the algorithm. Here's an attempt to interpret this. If you have this edge, and suppose it is shrunk by these values, so there are two cases. In the time automaton, an edge can be controllable, which means maybe the system should send a signal between 3 and 7 time units. Then this is easy to interpret. It should just send it between 3 plus 2 delta, 7 minus 4 delta. But sometimes the edges are not controllable. So for example, it can be the case that upon the arrival to L1, maybe you execute a task if you have a real-time operating system and just wait for termination. And then maybe this 3 and 7 correspond to best case execution time, worst case execution time. So and then you cannot control the termination. You just wait for the termination, and you have just a guarantee. Then I believe you should review your timing analysis and make sure that the task will terminate not later than 7 minus 4 delta, or do the necessary for this. And perhaps if it terminates before, then maybe you should wait a little bit before continuing. So that's how I would use these parameters. Okay, now in the rest, I'd like to show you a few techniques we used to compute these parameters. Now, I'll only consider non-blockingness. So a time automaton is non-blocking if whenever you take a transition and change location, you're able to take another transition eventually. So every execution can be extended to an infinite execution. And this can be also, for time automata, this can be expressed like this. So let G sigma be the guard of this edge, and G sigma prime is also the guards. So non-blockingness means that the guard of sigma should be included in the predecessors of the next transitions. So pre-time is time predecessors, and reset is the inverse of reset. So if the guard is included in the predecessors of the union of this next transitions, then of course you're non-blocking. And if this holds for all edges, then this precisely means that you have non-blockingness. But so let's simplify. So let's take this automaton. And now this is the condition for non-blockiness. So G sigma is included in the predecessor of sigma prime. Now, so let's just consider an example. Let's consider these guards. So these are zones, as we saw in the previous talk. This is the guard of sigma prime. This is the one of sigma. So the pre-time, so this is the time predecessors. This is easy to compute. This is just take this. This is the time predecessors. An unreal set is the set of valuations from which you can reach this set by resetting y. So just trust me, this is what you get, and you have inclusion. This means that this automaton is non-blocking. Or at least, okay, this condition holds for the edge sigma. But of course, what we want to do is to compute the parameters to get non-blockingness. So we want the same inclusion to hold when the guards are shrunk by some unknown parameters. So we want to determine integers k and delta for which this holds. So this is what we want to do. We want to shrink each guard. So shrinking is really, can be seen geometrically. It's reducing this thing. And these are so unknown parameters, k1 times delta, k2 times delta. And so ki are integers and delta is irrational. So the pre-time is, again, this. So this is not completely obvious, but if you can, we show that we will have some additional shrinking parameters in the diagonals, and we get here k1 plus k3 times delta, k2 plus k4 times delta. And the unreal set is this. So the same previous zone gets shrunk by k1 plus k3. And then, of course, you have inclusion if and only if k5 is greater than k1 plus k3. So you should shrink more here than in here. And this can be written as this using max. K5 should be the max of k5 and k1 plus k3. So what we did is this. We started with some equation on zones with parameters. And we have an equivalence with an equation on just integers using max and plus. So what is really interesting here is that here we don't have time automata. We don't have zones. We don't have these complicated things. We just have integers, positive integers, and actually we will only have max and plus. So this is the interesting thing. And actually this observation will always hold. So this is systematically, we show that this happens systematically. So given any fixed point equation on zones, so just think of this equation. So M is a set of guards. So it's a set of, it's a vector of zones. And F is a function using pre-time intersection, so well-known operations. So yeah, just like in here. And let M be a solution. So for any integer vector k, the solution shrunk by k times delta, for delta small enough, is a solution of this fixed point equation, if and only if the integer vector k satisfies phi, where phi is a max plus expression. So it's like in here. Phi is a fixed point equation on the max plus algebra. So it only uses max and plus. And yeah, we show that, you know, this is not very difficult. We show that these kind of equations can be solved efficiently in polynomial time. So now, to decide the shrinkability, so for non-blockiness, to compute these parameters, you just have to write what you want without thinking of the parameters. So just write down the non-blockiness, write down the simulation equation, and compute the solution. So the solution should be computable, which is for usual methods for time automata. And just compute this equation phi, so it is also computable easily. And once you have phi, just solve it. It's a fixed point equation on max plus algebra. And then this gives you, this will also always give you, a, this will also, this also gives a bound on delta, so you'll have a solution for small enough delta. Okay, so to summarize, shrinking, so it's a very simple idea. It always gives a good implementation, which is included in the specification, but it's not always such. It may not contain good behavior, so we synthesize these parameters to get non-blockingness, and we want the specification to be included in the implementation. And okay, the complexity varies from NP to X time. And yeah, what I didn't show you today is that these properties, simulation equivalence and non-blockingness, are preserved in program semantics. So this is non-trivial. So that I showed for the Schrank automaton, but in this concrete semantics, these properties are preserved. So from a technical point of view, I think what I find interesting is this relation between zones, Schrank pi parameters, and max plus algebra, which was unexpected for me. And so in order to deal with these zones, Schrank pi parameters, we use difference band matrices with parameterized max plus expressions. So this is a new data structure. And I believe it can be used for many other problems of this type. So we already have results on robust controller synthesis using this data structure. Okay, so thank you for your attention.